Did you see her? She's become like super friendly, like even more so. She just becomes this fun. All night.
Oh, no, the I four, no, the I four, you think hates me for I even. So glad we have spells when we just talk about.
It's like her class, like senior portrait. Yeah. I also have like the art. Put a cat in there. She's like.
The Committee on Economic Development will now come to order. Mr. Secretary, please call the roll.
Representative Brady.
Here.
Representative Skilvin. Representative Vett.
Here.
Representative Berry. Representative Dunn.
Here.
Representative Fitzwater. Representative Green. Representative Breyer.
Here.
Representative Lamb.
Here.
Representative Miller.
Here.
Representative Heitzman.
Here.
Representative Plucker. Representative Rowland.
We have established a quorum. We are going to hear House Bill 251. Representative Taylor.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. For the record, Jared Taylor, State Representative, District 139, which is the western half of Christian County. Thank you for allowing me to present this bill to you today. It's House Bill 251, also known as Paycheck Protection. We've heard it multiple times in this chamber, and I will kind of go over the main provisions of the bill, and then if there's any questions, I'd be more happy to answer them. This bill would require written or electronic authorization for the withholding of dues, agency shop fees, or other fees paid to a public labor union organization. Right now, a member must opt out if they choose to leave the union. Many unions have been known to create bureaucratic roadblocks, only allowing them to get out at a specified time of the year, or they must speak to a select union official, or they have to conduct multiple conversations about why they choose to cancel their membership. This bill will also require annual authorization for the use of dues, agency shop fees, or other fees for political purposes, which would allow members to be part of the union for collective supportive grievances, terms and conditions of employment, or other protections without having to give financial support to causes or individuals that the unions advocate for politically, which might not align with their personal philosophies. It would also allow, require unions to make available to all members a search for financial summary. And, you know, I think we've heard multiple times in the past how this legislation is going to help public employees. It can be intimidating to go to, you know, your union boss and tell them you want to opt out. And, you know, when they create these roadblocks, it just becomes more intimidating, more difficult. There's multiple reasons for this bill. It also adds transparency. And those are a few of the reasons why I brought this forth. But those are kind of the main provisions. I'd be more happy to answer any specific questions about the bill.
Thank you. Do we have any discussion from Representative Dent? Proceed.
Good morning, Representative. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Doing well.
Good.
A few questions that I have. I still just don't understand why this is needed. Employers have the ability to opt in, and this seems like the government reaching in and in a place where it doesn't need to be interfering with the ability for individuals to continue to make decisions that they already have the ability to do under current law.
Yeah, like I said, it becomes difficult. We heard a story last year where an individual was trying to get out of the union. She was told that she had to talk to a certain person. If that certain person wasn't there, well, then she was told she had to go to someone else. So yes, there is an opt-out option, but it's very difficult sometimes to get that ball to where it needs to go. And so this is making it a little bit easier for those members who choose, you know, that they don't want to be part of the union, to get out of the union rather than having to jump through, you know, 10 hoops in order to get out of the union. But it also has that transparency piece, which isn't there currently. The union members don't necessarily know where their money is being spent. With this transparency piece, what it does is it puts in place what private sector unions have to do already and provide a searchable data just to the members where their dues are being spent.
So is this, and I just, you know, I just want to be clear in terms of what you said. So this is about employers getting out of the union?
Employees, I'm sorry, is this about public sector
getting out of the union, or is it to prevent their dues that they voluntarily decide to give going to whatever purposes the union votes?
Yeah, so there's two key requirements in this provision or in this law. It would, one, require you to have authorization every year to say that you want to continue to be a dues paying member of the union. But then it also requires once a year for you to say, yes, I want my dues to be spent for political purposes.
Okay. And then a couple more questions, if I might, Madam Chair. Just looking at some data as it relates to the number of workers who are currently under union who want to continue to have their dues deducted. You know, one number I see is over 75% of union workers would want to continue to be able to have their dues automatically deducted from their checks. And then also, when we look at, there have been a number of states where similar legislation has been proposed, where the Supreme Courts in those states have found it unconstitutional. That includes in Alabama, Arizona, Washington. Again, they were ruled unconstitutional because they violate the First Amendment rights of those union workers who already, again, have the opportunity to opt out of having their union dues going toward political activity. Do you have any thing to say as it relates to that?
Sure, that I would say those 75% that want their dues to continue to be used for political purposes, it's not going to affect them. All they have to say is, yes, that's what I want. But for those 25% that don't, then they're going to have to say, you know, then it gives them an option of saying, no, I don't want my money being spent for a political purpose that I don't agree with. Your money shouldn't be spent for something that you don't agree with. Just like mine shouldn't be spent for an organization that I don't. So I think, yes, we might have 75% that it's not going to affect, but we do have a significant portion of those union members that it will affect.
And thank you for that answer. I think this is certainly one area again, I think we're going to have to agree to disagree on. I don't think that probably is a surprise to anyone here in the room or on this committee. Again, I just think this is the continual overreach of government into an area where it does not need to be. Current law allows for individuals to be able to opt out of having their dues going towards political activities, and I think we should honor the ability for individuals to be able to continue to do that and operate under the system that has worked for many people over a great period of time. You know, I just, this again just seems to be a continual attack on unions. You know, we had right to work, now here we are with what I would refer to as paycheck deception. And it just seems like we're continuing to try to chip away at the bedrock of unions, which have been a great benefit to many, not only in our state, but across the country. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Do we have further questions from the committee? Representative?
Madam Chair, to inquire. Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
Got a couple questions, like four questions.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to read them because I'm not, that's what I'm going to do. I hope that you as a bill sponsor understand that all Missouri public employees already have the freedom to join a union, not join a union, terminate their union membership at any time, choose how they will pay their dues from several options, choose whether or not to make additional voluntary political contributions in any amount they specify, and choose to change or terminate those contributions at any time. Given the voluntary nature of this participation, why are you imposing these state mandates and costs on employers, employees, and unions for choices they make freely and can change at any time?
I don't think there's going to be any additional costs. We're talking about an opt-in. That's an electronic way of doing it. All they have to say is yes or no. And if they have that option now, why not give them the option to do it on a yearly basis? And giving them a little bit more choice on, you know what, maybe their union isn't representing them the way that they want with their political funds, and so they decide that, you know, this year, you know, we just came out of an election year, so it's probably more relevant than it was last year. Maybe those union dues were being paid for a purpose that they didn't agree with, so they should be able to easily select that, no, they don't want to, they're dues being paid, you know, to those political functions, and likewise the membership as well to those dues, or, you know, their dues. You know, their union maybe not be representing them anymore, and so they should be able to opt out in an easy, quick fashion.
And they can do that now. They can do that right now. They can call up right now and drop
out. I think we've heard stories.
Is that correct?
No, I think we've heard stories where that's not the case, where it is difficult.
Is it the law?
It's the law that they're able to opt out, but
yes, thank you.
Again,
so thank you. Next question. I assume that you're aware that all school employees and school districts, payroll deductions of all types, are already handled by good law and good policy that was been in place and working well since 1983. HB 815 was approved overwhelmingly in the House, more than 150 in favor, and unanimously in the Senate, and was signed by Governor Bond. Other public employers have similarly and non-discriminatory policies in place to regulate payroll deductions. How do you expect school boards and other employers to reconcile their current non-discriminatory policies with the discriminatory mandates of this bill that targets certain employees, certain groups, and certain types of deductions?
I don't see the where it's discriminatory in any fashion. Can you point that out in this bill?
Yes. Well, you're not requiring superintendents who belong to associations, other groups that belong to associations that are.
I'm talking about associations. Payroll. We're talking about unions.
Associations. And so it's discriminatory to everybody else that belongs to an association to have these same dues and the opt-in policy or opt-out policy or however you're doing it every year.
No, gentlemen, we're specifically talking about public sector unions.
We're only talking about one
private organization, which is an association.
So you're not talking about one section of employees with a public body, one section of employees. You're not talking about the non-union employees or superintendents.
Sure, we're talking about the union employees.
Okay, I can also opt in. But we're not talking about both. You're just talking about one section, correct?
No, I believe it's talking about every public employee in the state.
Okay, so then superintendents, they opt in and out of their association that they belong to?
Which is a private organization.
So are you recommending that they do that also on a yearly basis?
If they choose, yeah, sure.
All right, I mean, are you going to put in a law, or are you going to?
I don't think we need to.
So you're only saying one sector of employees?
And you know why I don't think we need to is because those association fees are given by the by that employee, and where these are automatically taken out of your paycheck and you don't have any say in it.
Those are automatically taken out also, sir. How can they defend a policy that discriminates this way against only certain employees? Who will pay for the cost of litigation when public employers are sued for attempting to implement the mandates of this act?
So the bill specifically states who will pay the litigation in Section 7.
So when they're suing, what's the note on that? Is there a fiscal note?
No, gentlemen, hopefully they're not going to be disobeying the law. That would be up to them. I mean, if they decide that they want to not follow this law, then of course those penalties or those fees are going to be assessed to them and the organization.
Thank you. I just want to know, this is just another attack on workers, and it's to tilt the balance.
Gentlemen, this is a question.
What's kind of a statement?
Okay, I'll let you do a short one, but we need to move on.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want everybody to be aware that this is another attack on workers and their voice in the workplace and in general, and it's another tilt in favor of the CEOs. And also, since this is economic development, I have no idea what this bill has to do with economic development. We should be talking about roads, infrastructure, development, things of those nature, but obviously we're not, I guess.
Thank you, gentlemen. We'll be getting to those also. Do you have further questions? We'll go back and forth as we have before with those for and against. So someone for this policy would like to come up and speak on its behalf, please do. And witnesses, please be sure to fill out a witness form.
Thank you, Chair and Committee. My name is Jeremy Katie. I'm the State Director for American Prosperity, Missouri. I think the representative did a fine job going through the details of the bill. We just want to go on record in support of it. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to take them.
Questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Someone against?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Otto Fagan speaking on behalf of Missouri NEA. Missouri NEA does oppose House Bill 251. Madam Chair, I sent by email to your office written testimony, so I'm not going to repeat my written testimony remarks. I just wanted to share a few things. We keep hearing that somehow there's some kind of coercive element going on. I wanted to share just a little bit about our association. We're a not-for-profit corporation. Incorporated in the early 70s. We have about 35,000 members, all of whom are active or retired educators in Missouri public schools. We have a representative assembly, kind of like a miniature legislature, I would say, except that it's bigger than the General Assembly, that meets twice a year. That group elects our statewide officers. As terms expire, that group from the regions will elect the new board of directors, elected board of directors members. They'll also elect, as terms expire, our executive PAC council. So both of those groups are member-elected, member-driven. We're a not-for-profit corporation run by the bylaws that our members choose to have and amend. Like law, it's a laborious process to amend bylaws. That's the case for any not-for-profit corporation. Also, we hear things like how cumbersome to change the way you pay for membership dues. It's totally not the case. In education, we were right to work before we had bargaining rights. Supreme Court in 2007 said that public employees had bargaining rights. It was our INEA, Independence NEA decision that got the Supreme Court to look at the law, to the Constitution, actually, Article 1, Section 29, and say, for goodness sakes, it says all public, all employees, it doesn't say public or private, all employees have the right to bargain collectively. But long before that, the concept of using payroll deduction had come about. In the early 80s, the legislature said, we're just going to put a policy in place with some local control. And so you all passed a bill in 1983. There's one member still in office today who happened to have been around back at that time. That's Representative Nate Walker. And he voted for it, along with over 150 reps. Every senator was signed by Governor Bond. And it hasn't been amended since, because it already covers all the bases. In fact, in most ways, far better than anything that this statute would do. One of the dangers you get into is this is written in Chapter 105. It's completely not making any acknowledgement of the existing body of law. 168.300, which we brought to the attention of the relevant committee, not this committee, but the relevant committee for year after year after year, states very clearly. The school board creates the policy, and the policies of every school board, you can look them up on the website, they all look exactly like the statute. They follow the statute. So they decide, and they all, for their convenience, have said, it's important for us to allow deductions for all employees for all types. But it has to be done as directed by the employee. So since 1983, it's been very clear, and it has to be done within 15 days. So it's been very clear from 1983 on that anything that is done in terms of payroll deduction, any decisions that any employee makes, not just a union member, but if they're a non-union member, and for any purpose, whether it's deferred compensation, charitable donations, whatever it might be, it's treated on equal terms, pursuant to that law, done as they direct within 15 days. So within the time frame of the payroll period, the law says that's what is to be done. The idea that somehow adding on an extra annual renewal, saying the decision you made, we're going to make you second guess that every 12 months, is not an addition, but rather a nuisance for my members. I've never had one of our members say, we want you to come to the Capitol and advocate for a law that says you have to make this paperwork complete every 12 months. Never had any member ever say, we need a law to do this. If they don't want to be a part of our association, they quit. They file the paperwork, and there's a process to do that. If there is ever any question, the business official is 100% in charge under the law. And if there's any cost for doing this, which there no longer is, because it's embedded in what they have to do for other mandatory purposes like retirement and taxes, but if there were any embedded cost that was responsible for having to do the obligations for the voluntary deductions, we would pay for it. But we've checked with the school districts all over the state. They don't charge anything because it's embedded in what they already have to have. Now, what's at risk is for all those employees and for all those types of deductions, the school districts are protected by a fair, non-discriminatory policy that they can enact. This statute is drafted in an entirely different section of law, but it's going to speak to, does your policy, they're going to have to check with their attorneys and see, is our policy now compliant not only with the law you've been following for 34 years, but also with this statute, which particularly applies to certain types of employees, union members, and only with regard to particular deductions, but not to all the other deductions that they do. So that's an issue for school boards and other public employers. I also just want to point out one other thing. We heard from the sponsor that the intent of the records and financial information that's spoken to on subsections 6 and 7 is in reference to members of the association. It's not clear that the wording used accomplishes that because it speaks to public employees it represents. It would be clear if it said members, because it looks like it's telling us to give our financial information away to people who are not members of the association. With that, I'll conclude my remarks. Happy to take any questions the committee may have.
I have a question.
Sure.
And this is just, you know, I've carried this bill for the last several years, and this is just something that I just thought of that I just want clarity on. so in the process now, So there's a different, a separate deduction taken out for those that go to political purposes, if someone wants political purposes.
Right, it'll be spoken to separately in like the board policy, it's a separate deduction. And I know for our association, it is a separate choice. It's not part of, you know, there's dues to support the operating costs of the association, and then you can decide to add on and say, I want to bond, and it doesn't have to be by payroll deduction. You can write a check. You can go to our website right now if you want to.
Okay, so then my question was, is as public funded, as paid teachers or superintendents,
they're public employees,
or whomever, public employee organizations, are they, so they're collecting money for political purposes?
No, my members are public employees, but they are contributing their private owned dollars to a not-for-profit corporation that they have voluntarily chosen.
Okay, so we're it's not that the school system or that the state is collecting that money that then goes to your political account?
No.
Through that automatic?
Well, I mean, our members can choose to use payroll deduction through the payroll office of whoever their employer is to send money to the political accounts. Just like we can for retirement accounts.
So the state is collecting money for political purposes.
No, the state's not collecting the money. The state is just a transmitting agent. No, the state's not actually involved at all. The school district is just the payroll agent for their employees. This is no different than any other employer for that purpose.
Gotcha. Okay. Do we have other questions for this witness?
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Anyone for?
Morning. My name is Mike Hafner. I'm a registered lobbyist for Missouri Century Foundation. We are a nonprofit organization dedicated to free market principles and advancing those principles in our state. And we just want to go on the record in support of this legislation. We believe it's a good pro-worker reform that puts power back in the hands of our public sector employees. And be happy to take any questions.
Any questions? Seeing none? Anyone against?
Madam Chair, Representatives, my name is Sherwood Smith. I am the President of the Missouri State Council of Firefighters. I represent Missouri's over 6,000 professional firefighters, EMTs, paramedics, prosecuting attorneys. I come to speak against this bill. Some of the things I would like to point out is, as firefighters, our international does not accept agency fees. So that is it's a non-starter. That's one point that's in the bill that's a non-starter for us. Some of the other things that's in the bill that gives me problem or causes. Our members, as you know, are all in our association as voluntarily. But they also have three opportunities to opt out, at least three opportunities to opt out. One is they can call their political subdivision, whether it be a fire district, the city hall, or whatever. They can talk to someone at the union hall. Or the better option is they can just go on the internet in the privacy of their own home, late at night, early in the morning, any time of the day, and just opt out. They do not have to speak to a union official. They do not have to speak to anybody in City Hall. They do not have to speak to anybody in the fire department. So I think that's, if that is a concern, that concern is already being dealt with. One of the other things that I should point out is our members are all well aware that it is our association that speaks and advocates for the things that matter most to men and women on front lines here in Missouri. That is the safety of themselves and their community. It is our association and our affiliates that speak for and advocate for things such as the line of duty death, cancer presumption, staffing, better equipment, and those kinds of things. That is what our association does. The political side of that is that we simply support people that, whether they be Democrats, Republicans, Libertarians, Green Parties, that we simply support those that support the mission, that supports their own communities. Our bylaws, another point we should make is our bylaws make it, all of our bylaws, our international bylaws, which trickles down to the local affiliates, states that every financial, all financials must be read at every union meeting. Now, some of our affiliates don't have a union meeting every month. The larger affiliates, they'll have a meeting every month, but some of the, I'll give an example, maybe Lebanon, for instance, who has 12 members, they don't meet every month. But when they do meet, it's by bylaw, they have to read their financials. Also, at any time, those financials are available to a member by just asking. I should point out that another thing that I should point out is that our the leadership in our different affiliates, and I know this because I made 37 phone calls over the last 2 weeks to make sure that I was going to give you the accurate information. Out of those 37 affiliates, 28 of them are non-paid positions. And so what this law would do is require people who aren't even paid. They're there as volunteers. As I said once before, one of the affiliate leaders really didn't volunteer. He just wasn't there, so he got voted in. And so what happened there? What happened there is that we're not in one shop. We're not in one location. We have to. There may be 5 fire stations. There may be 35 fire stations. We are encumbering some non-paid members to visit each station every 12 months and speak to every man and woman to get them to sign in or sign off or whatever the opt-in or opt-out is, I guess is what you're calling it. And so I would like to point out some of these things that seem to be in the bill that are really non-relevant to the business or to the service that we serve. Again, our members, they're only there by volunteer. They also have the opportunity, 3 opportunities, to opt out at any time, not once a year, not twice a year, not on the 5th of every month, but at any time. And the most comforting thing is that they can do that without speaking with anyone besides the people in their household by simply going on the internet and opting out. I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you for your testimony. Questions, please, Representative, proceed.
How are you today?
Great, thank you.
Are these fees taken out before taxes are paid or after?
They're taken out at the same time.
Well, I mean, is it, because I'm trying to understand this, I meant to ask the other gentleman, I forgot.
Is it taxable, you mean, or the fees?
Do you take the fees out before the income tax deductions are made?
No, union dues are taxable, or you can use that as a deduction if you use a 10-4.
I'm guessing since you're all nonprofit, you're taking the money out and it's not taxed.
It is.
Basically, the state
is taxed. Yes, it is taxed.
So the state's receiving their income tax first, and then it's a voluntary thing.
Yes, and it's deductible if you use a 10-4 at the end of the year.
Okay. Another thing.
In most cases.
I keep hearing this, that we've already got these protections from you guys. And is this law overlapping that? If this becomes law, would it be overlapping the laws that are already in place?
I'm not.
Well, it sounds like I've heard several people say that they've already got this option. They've already got this right. So I guess part of me is like, well, what difference does it make? You know what I'm saying?
Well,
if this just clarifies it, to me, this is kind of foggy?
In some parts, as I understand your question, some parts, is that true? But the other part is, as I spoke about, one of the mandates in the bill requires, say, for instance, if I was the president of a local who had 50 stations, and there, I don't think there was any local in Missouri with 50 stations, but if there were, I would have to, you're requiring me to visit each of those stations once a year and on at least three shifts and capture the signature from each man and woman that works there. That is it's burdensome, it's redundant, and in my mind, I can't imagine why would we be asked to do such, especially since the Missouri State Council of Firefighters has a survey in the field right now. And those are one of the questions that we ask. It kind of alludes to this bill. And we started the survey actually in December. But these are not one of the concerns of our membership. Our membership, one is that they know that they can opt in and opt out at any time. And I think especially going back to the 28, which is like 87% of the local leadership who are in a non-paid position, to put that extra burden on them to visit those 50 stations times three, because we work on platoons, we work three shifts, to visit those three stations those 50 stations times three, is just a burden that's just unnecessary, encumbering, and really, I don't know why that would be expected.
If they can opt in and out at any time now, say they called you and they said, we want to opt out, does that mean you have to go visit them every time they call?
No, well, the easiest thing to do, well, it depends. So if they called me and I was at home, or they called me and I was at the fire station, the easiest thing for me to do would tell them to, well, go on the website and fill out the paperwork, do a couple of clicks, and you're done.
I guess my point is, if they can do that now, just go on the website, why can't they do it under this new law? Isn't that what we're trying to do? Without you having to go visit every one of them?
Well, when I say you have to go visit the fire stations, it's in the bill that somebody has to opt in every year. And so I don't know how you would expect them to opt in or opt out every year without putting something in front of them, asking them to sign in or out.
Okay, thank you.
I think I can help clear this up. It can be electronic, by electronic means. And so it could be something as simple as sending your members an annual email saying it's time to do your opt-in.
I guess that's what I was asking. If you could do it electronically, you don't have to go visit every one of them, correct?
Right. And there comes the redundancy, as if they can do that now, as you said, if they can do that now, why the redundant? My question would be, why the redundancy? If that is available now, which I think you heard everybody say, what's the difference?
And I think I can answer that, because, and this is one of the reasons that we've always had firefighters excluded, first responders excluded in years past, mm-hmm. is because they've had a really good system set up to get out without having that personal contact, without having to come back and send a letter. Wait a minute, we didn't get your letter, then you come back, you send a fax, and all this time your dues are still being withdrawn. And it was more the state employees that had a problem, that were having repeated problems with this. And so I appreciate you coming. We appreciate you coming and testifying. And I do like that you have multiple ways for someone to opt in and opt out without that confrontational or uncomfortable. You can do it in the privacy of your own home. But yes, in your case, this would be redundant. But it could be done by electronic means. So just an email once a year, annually, redoing your insurance. Annually, your medical insurance, or re-upping your 401k, it could be in paper form with those papers as well. So thank you so much. Do we have other questions? Representative, please.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Just a couple questions. Last week we heard how the teachers unions are flourishing because of the right to work and how great they are. And now this week we're basically trying to take away the rights of the workers, whether it's first responders, firefighters, police, nurses who work with our most vulnerable people in this state. And we're trying to take away their voice. And I'm just curious, it's...
Chairman.
I'm from a school
Representative, board. Representative. I guess I don't really understand your line of questioning. Who's trying to take away what voice?
Voice of workers.
By giving them an option to opt in and opt out?
Well, it's a mandate, and they already have these options. These options already have, what you just stated, are all unions have these same options that the firefighters have? There's multiple ways that they can opt in and opt out now.
Employees. Perhaps you missed that part, Representative. Perhaps you missed that part of the sponsors when he first gave his speech regarding this bill. I'll let you go ahead and ask the question, but this gentleman's with the firefighters, and they do offer those options.
I do know that. Thank you. So my question to you is, I come from a school board, so I like local control and things of that nature. This would circumvent that local control, and it puts a government mandate, something that we're always talking about, a little less government here, but yet we're putting more regulations and more burdens and mandates on local subdivisions, political subdivisions, and the workers that represent them. So do you see this as a burden, and do you also see this as a problem as far as constitutionality and things of that nature, discrimination?
Well, as a layperson, I can tell you when the last time I read the Constitution, but I can tell you that obviously it's a burden. I don't think anybody would not think that it's an extra burden that it would be put on men and women in the fire service and the public safety sector for sure, based on just some of the scenarios that I laid out in front of
you. Well, one more question though. When's the last time you partnered with Americans for Prosperity for advocating for workers' rights? Have you ever done that as a official?
I'm not familiar with American for Prosperity.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much for your testimony. Next witness.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mike Lewis, Missouri AFL-CIO, testifying against this bill. The firefighters and other witnesses have made all of my points, and I'm just here to say, stop the government overreach. That's all this is. The employees have all the rights that are contained in this bill. Why are you wasting taxpayers' dollars right here, right now, to create a bill that employees already have all those rights? As a matter of fact, under current law, employees can opt in and opt out whenever they want. Now you're putting a time frame on it. Why? Why are you doing this? Kind of a self-serving question, because I know the answer. This is nothing but a bill created to create hardships on organized labor. Therefore, as representative of the Missouri AFL-CIO, not only representing private sector, representing public sector. This is wrong. It's government overreach. That's all it is. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions from this witness? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Next witness.
Good morning, Chairman, Honorable Representative, Committee members. For the record, Clark Brown, Service Employees International Union State Council. We had a statement to make, and then I think that I could be helpful about several points within this piece of legislation. I have to come back. I heard the chairman make a comment. We've seen this legislation for 10 years. I know that the last 6 years we've had this bill voted, passed a couple of times, it's been vetoed. It all comes down to we see this legislation every year, And we hear about workers that, in fact, are making, the claim or the sponsors of this legislation that they have trouble getting down the union. I don't get it. And to be honestly helpful, I do rep work, union agent work outside of the session cycle here. I have public employees. So we have 13 different public employee contracts. I've never had a worker say, why is a lot of this trouble to get out? I even took phone calls from them and said, no problem. I'll send your message through to our invoicing, our accountant, and make sure you're off the next statement for dues deduction. But frankly, too, I want to make sure there's no intimidation about this. All these workers can frankly turn something into payroll and never even call us and just say, I wish to terminate my dues. That being said, that really emphasizes they already have this right about opt out whenever they want. It's not necessary to look at an opt in situation. I think, and I have to say here, this legislation keeps coming back. It's role model legislation. It came from the national think tank ALEC organization. This legislation's always written exactly the same way. I think that there was some confusion in the questions about these political contributions. You guys ask those questions. Legislation never changes. It comes back the same way. Hope to be helpful. So we know the real intent. I want to make point to the 9 sections in this legislation. Annual written. So we already got confused in that discussion because your legislation says it will require annual written, not electronic. We do that. I have no problem with the first paragraph. That's what we do with every public organization. I don't have agreement that it needs to be done annually. That's the only thing wrong in that first sentence or paragraph section. 2 and 3 subsections talk about all the political dues, and I have a prop for demonstration for you. We don't do political contributions in a public agency. We have 3 contracts with the state of Missouri. They don't agree to do that. For the demonstration, a typical union card has our application for membership, voluntary membership. It has a tariff portion down at the bottom that's supplemental for the political contribution side of things. And it actually says, I'll do my part to help elected officials. We call it Code Committee on Political Education. The back of it says very clearly I'm volunteering to contribute to COPE, but I have a big X on this because the state does not allow us to do this. The state actually, they designed and have a special card that doesn't have any voluntary political money collections there. So that should help in some clarity. I have 13 public contracts. We don't collect COPE monies in any of them. Dues is all that we do. That makes subsection 3 irrelevant. 4-5 talks about it can't be a condition of employment. We're being repetitive. Chapter 105.510 already says that public employees in Missouri, you have this in statute, that it cannot be a condition of employment to be a member or not be a member. So you already have those assurances or protections written in law for the workers. 6, 7, and 8 subsections all talk about reporting. We already do this. We do federal United States Department of Labor reporting. It asks us to fill forms out. I just got an email saying, get yours turned in. I have to show how much percentage of time that I spend on servicing versus charitable or political work. It's all reported to the Department of Labor, and it's all sunshineable requests by an employee anytime they want. Or an employer if they want to research, just or an elected official if you'd like. Go to the website and you can look at these LM2 forms. 9, the last piece, becomes irrelevant. You're just putting descriptions in here that we don't even do. I think agency shops written in there and a couple of definitions that, frankly, we don't have agency shop. There's not a public entity that ever agrees to agency shop, and that term is really wrong to use in public employment because if there were a public agency that would agree to something similar to agency shop, it wouldn't be called agency shop. It would be called an agreement to collect fair share fees. That is, I see so much confusion with that too in some of our right to work legislation and testimony. So I want to leave you with this thought, and the representative that inquired earlier. It's all unnecessary. Most of it we do anyway. And frankly, you're going to set a precedent. If we ask workers to opt in annually, they're going to think that they only get to opt out annually. So if a worker signs up, if I go to Fulton, I have a mental health workers contract, and I'm supposed to go on employee orientation on the 2nd. If I go up there, February 2nd, and I sign 3 of them up, and there's this law that says you have to annually do that, they're going to think they signed up for a year. I don't care if you're not saying that they only get to opt out a year. They're going to think, because the law says that annually they have to opt in, they're in for that period of a year. I think it's confusing. I think it's not necessary, as I said. Testifying from my years of representing public employees, I get phone calls all the time about somebody walks out. Frankly, it can be over. Our organizations endorse people they don't support. That it's against their morals, whether it's guns or choice or pro-life positions. But respect that, and no problem. You want out, you want out. That's so. That was a response to the coercion thing. I think that's what I have to say. Please answer any questions.
Thank you for your testimony. I have just a couple questions. So when you say that you guys are already doing 6, 7, and 8. So then what you're already doing would fulfill these requirements, or are you saying that you would have to do?
It would be repetitive, because your legislation says it's reported here in Missouri to the Department of Labor here. And we already do this reporting federally, is what I'm saying. And it's actually more accessible federally. I've looked at our own LM2s just to see what's listed. It shows my salary, it shows what percentage of my time are spent political, charitable, servicing, and so forth. It's all public information that's there federally on the website. This would just be proposing we have to do it with the state, which I think is very redundant and unnecessary, and puts a large chore on the state's department that you'll have to increase the funding line for the Department of Labor on the state level to keep up with all that. I see nothing in this bill other than the first paragraph and wanting annual opt-in. Well, outside of that, the rest of it is all unnecessary.
Okay, and I'll reread these sections, but I didn't think that this was requiring any additional filing than what's typically done with the public, with the private. And if that's what you guys are doing on the public side as well, sure. I thought that would, fulfill those requirements.
Yes.
That it's not an additional filing with the state, but I'll double check that. And then just to ask you, so just so I get this right, I know you showed the card with the X.
Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to gathering money or automatic withdrawal, the state is not doing any automatic withdrawals for unions that go into the political fund. That's all done on
that
your website,
correct.
Or on something separate, completely separate.
That's correct, Chairman. I've been a rep for 21 years. We've had state contracts for all those years. We have 3 different ones. They do not agree to collect political monies, never have.
Got it.
Nor do the 10 other public agencies that we have, which could be a county sewer department, a municipality, public library, all of them, none of them ever agreed to collect political monies. And it's probably just a good choice on a public employer to say, we're not interested in collecting your political monies. We don't agree to that. So frankly, 13 contracts that we represent, none of them collect political monies for us.
Okay, thank you. Are there additional questions for this witness, representative? Please.
How are you today? Very good, sir. I appreciate you coming in here. You're always good at answering my questions in my office. So, and you may not have this answer, but I think what you just said makes sense. And I agree with the gentleman from the firefighters union. Are all the unions pretty much doing this now? I mean, what I've seen, a lot of unions have different levels of how they're taking care of their people in some instances. Would this bill bring everybody together? that's not in line with this? And I know you say you are, but I guess, are there some out there that aren't?
To my knowledge, most all unions, there are five or eight that have some saturation or diversity of representing public employees. I think they all do legislation. I think they do written authorizations. It's voluntary. The reporting typically has to be done federal by any union. Yeah, I think it's practiced by pretty much all of them that I know about.
Okay, thank you.
Gentlemen, I just reread this section. Sure. And it doesn't say that you have to file anything with the state. So just to, and if you want to, if you find something in there and you want to come see me later, please do. But in its original intent, and from what I'm reading, it doesn't require any additional filing. And then it can be done electronic. So we do have in that first section that it is, we are able to do just electronic authorization. It doesn't have to be paper format.
I missed that then. So if I relook at that, you're saying subsection one, the very first section, right, says it can be by means electronically?
Annual written or electronic.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I don't know that we like that. I think the worker probably prefers to sign a written form. We probably like to keep written ones. If an employer called us and said, well, how do we know this worker signed up? It's probably better to be able to photocopy and mail them a proof of a card, you know.
And thank you. Does anyone have any additional?
Thank you, Madam Chair. You have, how many members do you have total across the country? Do you, are you aware of that number?
2.1 million members.
And you're saying there's no political contributions or any of those efforts?
No, in the private sector, yes, we do. And that's why I was clear to demonstrate to Card. Our political monies mostly is from private sector. I know it is in Missouri now. Other states, like, it could be different, but it is a voluntary fund. And I think I've answered your question. It's not public in Missouri, but yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Also putting on the record, in their absence, Richard Craighead, United Steelworkers District 11 opposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Martin Burns on behalf of the Fraternal Order of Police. The firefighters did a great job of explaining the issues that affect us, but I'll add one more thing real quick, and that's the primary reason why our members join. We have over 6,500 members in the state, and that's for our legal defense fund, because in this day and age, you know, a law enforcement officer can find himself on the front page of the newspaper just for doing his job, and they might need some good representation. A lot of municipalities don't have the capability, smaller municipalities don't have the capability to provide that legal defense for the officer. So that's why we're there. Do you have to answer any questions?
Any questions for this witness? Representative?
Mr. Browns, how are you?
Good morning, Representative.
You're one of the few lobbyists that I enjoy in this building.
Thank you.
We have an immense respect for each other.
Yes, sir.
And you and I have worked on a project together.
Yes, sir.
And so we got to know each other and get an understanding of each other. With that being said, I just came out of the election cycle, as did everybody else in this room. And the FOP was very active and involved in my campaign against me, which is fine. I had several of your members that are constituents of mine tell me that they were upset that their dues were being used against me, and that they were afraid of opting out, and they weren't even sure how to opt out. Is that process known to the individuals of the FOP? Do they get that on a yearly basis of, hey, these are your options, this is what is available if you so choose?
Sure, when they sign up, they have the information that they receive when they sign up, it's spelled out in there that they simply have to go on the website and choose to opt out. So it's as simple as that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Additional question? Representative Heisman? Proceed.
You just made me think of something. So you said they have to go on there to opt out. So when they become a member or join the police force, are they automatically in?
Or no,
do they,
sir.
Do they do that when they sign up?
They have to choose to opt in. Yeah, they're not automatically in.
Now, what percentage of your, because I've had, I know it's a union thing, but I've had some of them complain to me about they're worried about their pension, and I asked them how their pension looks and how it's funded. They have no idea. They've never looked at it. They have no way of being accessing it. They don't think they have the ability. So that's what that brought up. Is it easily accessible for them?
So their pension is not through the FDIC.
Well, I know that's another question, but my point was, they're pretty passionate about it and they're worried about losing it, but the right to work thing. But when you ask them, they've never even looked at it and they have no idea what's in it, what percentage is funded. So I'm wondering if they're actively involved with this part of it, because they are the pensions. You know what I'm saying? Is it something that comes up at the meetings? You all want to opt out of this? You know what I'm saying? Like you said, some of them don't even know how they're taking it.
I'm not sure I'm following your question.
I'm just wondering how easily accessible it is to them, where if it was set up on a yearly renewable thing, like Rob said, his constituents would be more involved with the process. Would that force them to become more? I'm one of those guys, I want people to get involved with everything.
I don't know if it would force them or not, but I mean, I can just speak from personal experience. I'm a retired firefighter, and so, you know, I wasn't forced to join the union. I chose to join it, and I chose to be very involved because I wanted to know what was going on with my dues and with my organization. So I just think it's up to each individual. It's incumbent upon each person to be as involved as they want to be.
Okay, because I too, I know some that they feel like they're intimidated if they do go in there and opt out, because they'll be retaliated against. So
we had several members on my fire department that chose to opt out, and that there were no repercussions.
Is that right? Okay. Thank you, sir.
Representative Lee.
Or so you mentioned earlier in your testimony that if you stay in the union, every one that you represent, and there's things that occurred, and you may need an attorney down the road.
Correct.
You take care of that, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you don't pay into the union and you get in trouble, so you're not a member, you are still assisted with those problems?
Typically, we do not.
You do not. Okay. So going back to some of the benefits of being a part of the union and paying the dues, can you explain some of those? What are some of those benefits besides just the legal, please?
Sure, we need education processes. So every law enforcement officer in the state has to be post-certified through the Department of Public Safety, and we assist with those issues of trying to set up educational deals so officers have in their CEUs so they can get recertified when they need to be. We do lots of community involvement, and so it gives our officers a chance, in addition to their job with their organization, they can get out and be involved with the community and get to know the people they work for a lot better that way. Thank you. Thank you.
Representative.
Proceed. Thank you, sir, for being here this morning.
Thank you.
As I'm wrapping my head around the issue and understanding all the nuances and the impact of the laws that we make here, I'm just curious with this. Obviously, there are a lot of benefits that your organization provides to its members. You wouldn't have the numbers that you do if you didn't provide a valuable service. Do you feel that this law would increase or would it decrease your membership?
I'm not really sure. I just think portions of it might make it more burdensome for them to continue that membership. So I really don't know if it would have an impact on people choosing not to join.
Okay, all right.
Not sure.
I understand, I think, the perspective that this could, there could be a potential for a small inconvenience for folks after re-up every year. That's one perspective. But I always try and look at alternative perspectives too. And as I'm hearing the discussion this morning, an alternative perspective occurred to me that, you know, perhaps this is an opportunity for the organizations, if the choice is already there and they can opt out any time, whether it's mandatory that state requires it or not, it could be an opportunity for your organizations to use that as a chance to champion the fact that your members are choosing to re-up with you. It's a reaffirmation of the benefits and the services that are provided by your organization. And it's an opportunity for you all to kind of tout that, hey, our members every year, they have to choose this, and they are choosing to stick with us, and they're appreciating the value of what we're providing. A good thing for your organizations to be able to do that.
If the bill becomes law, I would hope that we would choose to do it in that manner too.
Thank you. So we've already established that your union is, for lack of a better term, a right to work now as we speak. So nobody's forced to join the union. We can opt out at any time they want. Period, right? Correct?
Correct.
So that's correct. So do you think this is overreach and it's imposing more of a burden on unions and employees?
We just feel it's pretty easy right now to join or to opt out. So we just want to keep it easy for our members. So because they have a very difficult job the way it is.
So when we heard the terms like force and mandate something on an employee, that would kind of be a burden for that employee or the union itself.
We would probably view it that way.
Yes. One other question. Have you ever partnered with Americans for Prosperity for workers' rights or advocating for workers that you can recall?
Not to my knowledge, since I've been involved with the organization.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Next witness.
Anyone for informational purposes only? Seeing none, this will conclude our hearing today. Thank you so much.